There are two types of stresses that are encountered in a soil mass. First is normal stress and next is shear stress. So when we studied consolidation settlement, so it was there due to some effective stress, and effective stress analysis also we studied. So this effective stress was of a category of normal stress, and this normal stress was of compressive nature. So when we talk about the normal stress, so in the case of soil, this normal stress is going to be compressive because soil cannot take any tension. So this was the first stress, and the next stress that is encountered in the soil is the shear stress. So whenever there is a case of sliding, that means that whenever there is a case of that a part of soil mass tries to move away from the rest of the parts, in case of dam, embankment or this canal, so in that case, because of this slope, or in case of foundation also, this soil will try to move away from rest of the soil. So whenever there is a tendency of some soil particles to move away from rest of the soil mass, there are shear stresses. And so what is shear strength? Shear strength is the maximum shear stress that can be withstood by the soil mass, or that can be resisted by the soil mass. And in soil, so we studied these normal stresses. So this soil does not fail by this compressive stress. It means that compression means what? Crushing of particle. So before this crushing can ever happen, the soil will fail due to shear stress. So in soil, the failure is always due to shear stress. That means shear failure will occur in the case of soil. So the next is how the soil resists the shear stress. So that is mechanism of shear resistance. It can be understood with the block and this surface analogy. If this is a block and this surface is having a friction coefficient mu, and from here we apply some force P, and from the top there is a force N. So if this force P is sufficient to just move the block, then in that case P is equal to mu N, that we know from our basic understanding of friction, what we studied in school. So P is equal to mu N. So here P is similar to the shear stress, or because it is force, so we can say shear force. So what is it proportional to? It is proportional to the friction coefficient, and it is proportional to the normal force. It means that if this friction coefficient is more, then more shear force will be required to move this block, and on the other hand, if this normal force is more, then also more shear force will be required. So if we go to a soil mass, and this mu here, if we talk about the soil, so this mu will be equal to 10 phi. So this phi is known as angle of internal friction. And here we can show this angle of friction, internal friction, as this is P, this is N. So this is the angle between resultant and the normal force. So this angle is called as angle of internal friction in case of soil. So if we talk about the soil, so here we saw this is a block and this is the surface. But in case of soil, there will be particles and there will be contact forces between the particles. And there is not a single block, there are a lot of particles. So when there is this N force, so this is not a single N, there are many particles, so these forces will also be high in number. So we can say that in case of soil mass, if shear strength or more shear is resisted, more shear stress is resisted when the contact force is more. So when this N, if this is more, then these particles will be in contact with each other. So because of that, more shear can be resisted. And the next is more number of particles in contact with each other. So if more particles are in contact, that means so this force will also be increased, and because of that more shear can be resisted. So in case of soil, this is not just the angle of internal friction, it is also about the interlocking. Because why interlocking? Because this surface which is there between the particles, it will not be a linear surface. So these particles will interlock with each other, and if the shear failure has to occur, so for that this interlocking has to break. This interlocking is more prevalent in case of dense sands, because in case of dense sand, angle of internal friction is more. So this is one way by which the soil resists the shear stress. That is the whatever we saw is the frictional resistance. But in case of clayey soils, as I said when I talked about the clay water relationship, so in case of clayey soils, there is some attractive force between these clay particles, and that we call as cohesion. So even when this normal force which is there in case of frictional resistance, even when this normal force is zero, shear strength will not be zero because there is this cohesion. So shear strength will be equal to the cohesion. More about it we'll see in the further lectures. So these are the two things by which the soil resists the shear stresses, that is frictional resistance and cohesion. So having understood this, the mechanism of shear resistance, there are two questions that we want to answer. That is, what is the stress at failure? That means what is the shear stress at failure, and what plane it is going to occur. So if we know the shear stress at failure, so we can limit our stresses on that structure, so that structure will not fail. And if we know the plane of failure, so we can take preventive measures and we can strengthen that plane of failure so that failure will not occur. So these are the two things that we need to answer. So here we'll see about the first thing, that is what is going to be the stress at failure. So that question is answered by the stress strain curve of the soil. Here I have drawn the same. So there are different kind of conditions. It is in brittle condition or work hardening or work softening. So let's see one by one. So if it is a clay soil at low moisture content, so it behaves as a brittle material. So if the material is brittle, it means when we increase the stress, so up to a point the stress can be increased, and then the sample will suddenly break. What will be the plane of this failure, that we'll see later, but this sample will break. So that means there is this definite point at which we can define this is the stress at failure. So that is about the brittle soils. And next is work softening. So work softening are the soils in which as we increase the stress, the strain will increase. But as we reach this maximum point of stress, after that strain will increase but the stress decreases. And so this happens in case of dense sands and sensitive clays. So why does it happen? Because in case of dense sand, these interparticle bonds are, or interlocking is very strong. So as we increase the stress in this zone, so the stress will be increased in this particles and it can resist those stresses. But after a certain point, that is the maximum point of stress, the structure of this dense sand will change. What will happen? First, this structure is like this. Let's say these are the rounded particles. So, and this is the first surface. And after that, the second surface occupies this voids of the first surface. And after a certain point of stress, what happens? It takes the shape of different structure. That means these grains will come over one another. That means the voids have increased. And if voids have increased, that means it will go under more strain. So this is the case of work softening clay, work softening soils. So in this case, the stress at failure is given as this point, the maximum strain. But practically we cannot take this maximum strain, because maximum strain means that even if the soil is not failing, but it is going under more settlement. So due to this settlement, we have to limit the settlement also in many cases, or in most of the cases. So because of that, we cannot take this point of maximum strain as the stress of failure. We take some percentage of strain for the stress at failure. That is the case of work softening. And the last is work hardening. So work hardening are the soils in which what happens? As we increase the stress, or as the strain increases, the stress also increases. So it happens in case of loose sands. So what I showed here, so in case of loose sand, the initial structure will be somewhat like this, that there will be very large voids. But as you apply the stress or the shear stress, what will happen? This will get a better packing, and this will obtain, these particles will come closer and the packing will be better. So if this packing is better, it means that angle of internal friction, that is phi, it will increase. So if it increases, the shear strength also increases. It means that the stress at failure will be increasing, or the strength of these soils will be increasing as we increase the stress. So in this case, in these soils, stress at failure, we do not consider as if that this strength will keep on increasing. We just, in this case also, we take some percentage of strain. So some percent of strain is taken as stress at failure. So using this stress strain analysis, we can find out the stress at failure. So for this stress strain analysis, triaxial or direct shear test can be conducted. So in case of triaxial test, we measure normal stress and normal strain, and we plot these two. Whereas in case of direct shear, we plot shear stress and shear strain. So that's something you can remember as objective point of view. And apart from that, so that's it for this one. So this way we can find out the stress at failure. Next question that we want to answer is the failure plane, and that we are gonna see in the next one. Thank you.